Okay.
Day after day.
Welcome back to Not Being Funny to Two Grumpy Retro Gamers. Last week you found us wandering around with the Sony PlayStation 2 looking at Hitman contracts. This week we're looking at the superior 128-bit system, the Sega Dreamcast. I'm fair collecting Forbes Longdon.
I'm riding the bus lane, Mike Langerbeer.
Like it good.
I think so. Right, yeah, finally, moment has arrived. Crazy taxis, been a lot of talk about this. And yeah, let's get on it. Crazy Taxi, tell me about it.
Crazy Taxi is, in my opinion, one of the finest Sega Dreamcast games that there is. Whenever you think of Sega Dreamcast, you think of maybe a handful of titles. You think, naturally, Sonic Adventure, we've covered that in our first episode of the Sega Dreamcast.
Shenmue, absolutely.
And Crazy Taxi being another franchise which is synonymous with the Dreamcast. Now, although it appeared on other formats, the Dreamcast version, to me, is arguably the best version. You have a console which I feel was crafted around arcade hardware at the time, being very closely based on the Naomi arcade system, which the Dreamcast, when they were developing, they had in mind that they wanted to base it on their latest arcade software, hardware even. So I feel that when you pick up Crazy Taxi, you have the Sega Dreamcast, you have a merging marriage together of the greatest combination you could ever want. And I feel that I'm looking at this controller, I'm looking at a little visual memory unit as it's bouncing away there with the Crazy Taxi logo, and it's saying, play me.
Well, do you reckon this is the best one? I mean, came out of arcades '99.
Yeah.
This came out on Dreamcast 2000.
Yeah.
But came out the other consoles a year after.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be a little bit better on the consoles?
No, not so.
No?
You have the other console, but other 128-bit versions that came out the year later, but they were straight ports. And I believe that both the PS2 and the GameCube versions weren't as strong as the Dreamcast version.
Right, so you reckon this is truly the best one?
This is truly the best one.
I think I agree with you there.
Yeah?
Yeah. So let's find out what ratings will be given this game. Is it worth putting into that slot with the greatest games ever, as we always do, or is it worth putting in the bin?
The Two Grumpy Retro Gamers bin, which you've just introduced.
Yes, it's down here. Oh, cannon fodder. I wonder what that was.
Cheeky little. Right. So, are we going to give it a play?
You want
to... I've got to get in. We've been teasing it for weeks and we're coming to Crazy Taxi. I can't believe it. The boyhood dream is here. What do you reckon? About 5 minutes?
Do you reckon you can get three done in 5 minutes?
Yeah.
There's different passages you can pick up. They got circles around them. You just got to drive into that circle, park, no, jump in. Which one are you going with?
I'm going to go with Gus.
Yeah. Best looking car, I find. It's a lot smoother, bolder.
Yeah.
Yeah, than the others.
Yeah, I find that the texture mapping on the car is far better.
Yeah, definitely.
Especially on the back, you've got a sort of shadow effect on the bumper and stuff, and it really...
Right, so here we go. It's going straight for yellow. It's the medium one. I think you go from green, yellow, red. Green being the easiest, red, of course, the hardest. Hardest being the further the journey. So, it's a medium journey. How he's making some money here is by stunts, dodging cars, jumping over things, you get money for it. You crash, they don't like it, kind of slap you about.
It kind of annoys them a little bit, doesn't it? Yeah, slapping you in the head and stuff like that.
Yeah,
if I was driving a cab, I wouldn't allow for that sort of behaviour.
No. I think Ford's going to do very well. I remember him being quite the master on this one. He always beat me. You always did.
That was when we were like,
frustrating.
When we were like 14.
Yeah. I think I did better on Crazy Taxi 2, but you wasn't quite partial to that, was you?
No, I didn't really like the jumping mechanism that he introduced into.
Yeah, I remember. We should definitely play that soon now.
Yeah, we'll cover that in a future episode.
Well, of course, it tells you where they want to go. If you don't know your way around, you've got that big arrow at the top.
What you have is quite an aggressive pop-up system of the game as well, which was actually present in the arcade version.
Mm.
So it's not just the Dreamcast and other subsequent console ports that you know, have that sort of form there.
Go on that one. You haven't done a red one yet.
Wow, I know, but we will.
Do a red one next.
Do you want to find one? I'm not a piece of meat, Michael. I can't just... What's he doing?
So, of course, the objective of this is to basically be a taxi driver, pick passengers up, get them to their destination at a certain time. Luckily, there's no police around, so you can just bomb it.
I've always wondered that. Why are there no feds?
Yeah. You'd think it would introduce it in, like, the second, third one, but no, nothing.
I saw a red one behind us.
Yeah, I saw that too. So, yeah, basically, get there as fast as you can, get very appreciative, give you loads of money. The amount they pay as well for one ticket.
It's a lot, isn't it?
Rich
it's like
people,
a London yeah. cab, isn't it? Where's the red one go?
I don't know.
Try and find one.
I don't know.
We definitely saw a red one, didn't we? I'll tell you what, I'm going to carry on picking up some others so I don't look rubbish while I'm playing it.
Ooh. There's a ball there. Sorry, I was playing this a minute ago and he kept mocking me for everything I was doing. Nothing was good enough for this little place. Underwater. Wrong way. There's a red one.
Red one, yeah. Sadly, you can't kick the passengers out of the cab.
Well, you could wait until the timer runs out, because that way they just they don't like it, they don't pay you anything, and they just jump out. Nice little jump.
Ooh. Nice bit of slowdown there.
Yeah.
Dropping to probably about 20 frames per second there. But that's also present in the arcade version of the game.
Ooh, nice. Oh, you're not finding it. 8 seconds.
No, I'm not going to get a good rating for this, am I? Just going to kick the cab, I should imagine. Yeah, there we go.
Didn't like that, did she?
Holy smokes, woman. Right, the red ones are actually really sparsely placed around the city, and I don't seem to be able to find one without having a fare in the car.
So yeah, the reason he's getting money then is just simply quite close to the cars, but dodging them at the same time. If you're far away from them, it doesn't give you any money, unfortunately. Oh, just crash into the cars right there.
Well, that stops me, doesn't it?
I actually liked it.
I just want to get an A rating.
I think he's avoiding
the red hard.
So I don't know if you can tell. I mean, this is actually the second game now. It's quite a fast-paced game. Sonic Adventure was quite fast as well, wasn't it?
Yes. That was the thing with the Dreamcast. I found that everything was very arcadey experiences.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I think that really worked in the console's benefit. Certainly well remembered for fun, fast experiences.
Yeah.
At the time, it was actually at its detriment that it had these experiences that were quite paper thin, but as it's got older, I think it's fondly remembered for this.
Mm. I think you enjoyed yourself then?
I took the long way round, didn't
you
I?
You did, yeah.
That was a red one. We finally found a red one, people.
Right, we've got a red one in 29 seconds.
Come on, get in, mate.
Big guy. He was there a minute ago, so you know where you're going.
I've got 20 seconds on the clock.
Do you reckon you'll do it?
No.
Bouncing around. Ah, oh, he's got it. Perfect.
Excellent.
That was amazing. Well done, you.
Thank you. Oh, we've got a...
B rating?
I would hope that I get an A for that, but let's just stop there. Okay.
So that's your 5 minutes.
How many customers do we get? 7 customers.
It's not bad. B.
Did you pay for it to
B.
say that?
Well. That was pretty good, man.
Yeah. You legitimately saying that, or?
No, not yet. It was really good. It was really good.
Little face every time, isn't it? Right, okay. So basically, what we have is a single-player only game for the Dreamcast. Now, the console initially was marketed very much as a multiplayer machine. Many people remember the infamous up to 6 billion players slogan they had for the machine. Mm. It's got 4 controller slots locally on the front of it. So it was quite interesting they released a single-player only experience.
Yeah.
But that is purely because of the arcade nature of the game itself.
That's right.
That originating from the arcade, you actually didn't get multiplayer networked games.
But to be honest, we played it. We didn't need it.
No,
because you do a level, I'll do one. We do one, you do.
Taking turns.
Yeah.
So I think it's really working its benefit being a single player game and not being multiplayer and not shoehorning in network play, which the Dreamcast was probably the originator of, or at least the forerunner for online gaming out of the box. So I'm glad they didn't put in an online mode of it, because it probably would have diluted the experience overall. Now, as you said, it came out a year later in the arcades, from the arcade version on Dreamcast, and it came out a year later again on the consoles. That version particularly was ported by Acclaim, because I think Sega were pretty popular by that point.
Yeah.
What's worth noting is the Dreamcast-only sequel, Crazy Sexy 2, it only featured a character called Hot D, who was a new character in the game, and I'm pretty sure if you take Hot D as the acronym, I'm pretty sure it's House of the Dead. Hot D.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I don't know whether they deliberately did that or whether, you know, it's basically franchise sort of intercross there, but I think Sega were quite clever about that. And also with the second game, they have The Offspring and I think Bad Religion also returning for the soundtrack, but they drop an expletive in Crazy Taxi 2. It's almost like Sega just didn't care by that point. But like, whatever.
Probably didn't.
Yeah.
They probably looked at their figures. Not doing that, though.
We're stopping making these consoles anyway. It's only going to be on this one.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Yeah, we're going to have the S word put in there. So that's fair enough. So, to add some longevity to the title itself, you have the Crazy Box mode, which is like a collection of sort of mini games that improve your skill on the overall game.
Yeah.
So the ability to be able to skid, do the sort of turbo boost with the gears, like I was sort of demonstrating there. And basically just being able to
isn't it?
It's putting into reverse and putting into drive with the trigger.
Yeah, right.
So it's quite, it helps you throughout the game. And I think everything in the Crazy Box mode just helps your overall experience of the game itself. We've got Bad Religion playing over the top here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, bit of Offspring beforehand. The arcade version only has one stage, whereas the Dreamcast and other console ports had two stages, which I think are based around San Francisco and California.
Yeah. For the hills.
Yeah, the Dreamcast having the original mode, which actually mixes up the level, so it's slightly more interesting for you if you want to play through over and over and over again, which I spent many a time when I was 15 years old playing it over and over again.
That's it, yeah. I remember it well.
Yeah,
my like I said, I just couldn't beat you on the income that you took. I think a couple of times on Crazy Sex 2, because you didn't really agree with it.
No.
You wasn't really into it, so no. Took my chance. And
wasn't really my thing, was it, boy?
No. But this one, yeah. He was unbeatable.
Less said about Crazy Sexy 3, the better.
But I did it for the fun of it. About 5 minutes.
The arcade rules mode is actually quite interesting, because you get 1 minute, but in that time, when you pick up more fares, it gives you more and more time.
Mm.
So it gives you a time extension each time, almost like a checkpoint system. And if you're really good at the game, you can just keep playing and playing and playing.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's pretty fantastic, to be honest.
Yeah.
So you have different options, 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 3 minutes, and your 1 minute version where you can build up more and more time depending on how good you are at the game. Now, someone like myself, before games like Grand Theft Auto 3 came out on the PlayStation 2, this was the most open world game that I'd experienced up to that point. So I used to have a cheat disc that would add infinite time to it. So I could just keep playing and playing and playing. Naturally, there's no way to end the game then, because you're just in the game world forever. I used to just drive around all the time.
Yeah, just getting used to it.
Drive around.
On this one though?
Yeah.
There's not much to the level though, is there?
No, but back then it was a revelation. Massive revelation. It was this, it was so open world. I've never experienced anything like it.
I think in the second one they had 4 levels. if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I remember the Big Apple being in it, New York.
Remember that nighttime one?
Yes. Yeah. It was Chris 33.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, that was Vegas, wasn't it? Las Vegas.
But still, you get more options in the second one, though. That's what I find.
Yeah, you do. They expanded on the concept and actually added an online ranking system, I think, for it as well. But getting a PAL copy of Crazy Taxi 2 can be quite difficult now.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, it sort of came out when Dreamcast had already died, so there weren't many copies out in the wild. I mean, Dreamcast software is quite rare anyway.
Yeah.
You could probably find a PlayStation 2 or GameCube copy of this game quite easily. A Dreamcast copy can be quite difficult to find, especially out in the wild.
Where did you get this copy from?
This copy is the copy that I got for my birthday.
Yeah.
In 2001. It came from an electronic boutique.
Nice.
Yeah, it is.
Brand new.
Yeah, certainly
did. Really good condition.
Yeah, yeah.
So the amount of times you've moved.
And the amount of time it's been used.
And used.
Yeah. No, my mum bought me that and I've looked after it ever since.
Good.
It's a fantastic game. But this was created by Sega's subdivision Hitmaker, which was Kenji Kano. And his team that worked on this game, creating the arcade version first and then the Dreamcast version after that. Now, as I touched on there, the Naomi hardware, which was Sega's arcade boards, which preceded the successor to the SVT Titan, I think it was called, which was based on the Saturn.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then Naomi was based on the Dreamcast hardware. So it made it very easy in 1999-2000 for Sega to just port all their arcade games over to the Dreamcast. Very minimal effort, and you had just these fantastic experiences on Dreamcast, which actually added, I think on Metacritic, the Dreamcast had the highest rated software of all time at one point, based on the games that it had. Yeah.
Something that's 18 years old, I mean, I must admit, it's looking pretty good.
Yeah.
And the colours there, I mean, you know, tarmac's not so bad, you're only riding on that. You've got buildings, you've got the backgrounds, everything like that.
Well, one thing that's notable on the Dreamcast version over the PS2 version is there's not jagged lines on the textures, whereas the PS2 version, you sort of get jaggies.
Yeah, you do. Been boxy, the Sony games.
Yeah. But then this is really the hardware it's been designed for. Now, when you even look at the brake lights on the taxi itself, you've got illumination there, which is quite clever for its day.
Yeah.
It actually does really look like proper shadow assisted illumination, which I think is very, very impressive for 1999.
Of course, now, obviously when you drive along, things start to appear in the background.
Yes.
Which is obviously standard for this year of gaming. However, a lot better than Sony did. That wouldn't come up until you was right there, really, would it?
Yeah.
Bam, flash, which is especially with the open worlds.
No, I think initially Dreamcast software was far stronger than PS2 software. Certainly the PS2 took the advantage later on once people started to learn how to code for it. But the Dreamcast was very, very easy to code for, which really worked in its benefit. Now, this game was also ported to Windows in 2002, as well as the console version that came out. They had an iOS version which I believe came out in 2012. And also in 2010, you had the PlayStation Network version, also Xbox Live Arcade, and it was appeared on the Dreamcast collection for PC and Xbox. But one thing that's worth noting is that the Offspring and Bad Religion soundtracks were removed from the game, so you just had a generic soundtrack which went with those versions. Now. You had also those versions of the game forced into a 4:3 resolution, which Dreamcast can't do widescreen.
Right.
So it's in your 4:3 CRT television method, really, if you don't know what 4:3 is.
Mm.
Whereas really you would expect later versions to be forced into widescreen rather than 4:3. But yeah, it's a fantastic game.
Yeah.
I think it's aged really well.
I think it has, yeah. I mean, the music added to it, I mean, I love this music.
Yeah.
This in a game, fantastic. You don't have to bother putting on that CD player. Straight into this.
No, it's actually fantastic, and it really sort of sets the flow for the game. Mm. It's fast paced. You've got this sort of rock soundtrack that's playing. Very 2000s.
Yeah.
greatest artists. Yeah, all you need now is just a bit of Linkin Park playing in there, and you've got your black hoodie on, a bit of eyeliner on, black nail varnish, and you're all good, aren't you? Right? Now, you had a larger map on the Dreamcast running through the game for the original mode versus the arcade map. The arcade map's a lot smaller and condensed versus the original mode.
Yeah.
What is translated into every console version is the sponsorship deal as well. So you have Levi's, you have KFC, Pizza Hut, Tower Records.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so there's a good amount of sponsorship. I think that was taken out in the later, newer generation.
Yeah. Is that included in the Sega collection that it does?
The Dreamcast collection?
Yeah.
Yes, well, it's not really a Dreamcast port of the game.
Mm.
No, they've. I think they cheated somewhat. They didn't really use Dreamcast code. I think they just used the arcade version, and then they stripped out bits and pieces because you couldn't have the sponsorship or the music license. But this actually shifted 750,000 copies in the USA alone on the Dreamcast.
Wow.
A million copies combined with PS2 and Dreamcast. Yeah. So, yeah, Dreamcast actually carried the weight for the sales of the game.
Oh, of course, yeah.
It was one of the few games that made it to the All Stars range in North America for Dreamcast as well, which. There weren't many games in the range, I think maybe 10-15 games in all. And I think this might be the second best selling Dreamcast game of all time.
Right.
Yeah.
We keep picking these games, don't we?
We do.
Best selling game of all time, that's all we keep picking.
God, yes.
Because we know what's good, really, don't we?
Let's pick good games. Our name is ironic.
Not that's grumpy. It. We would be grumpy with a game that we don't like, but why would we play that?
No, that's the trick.
You know, we might come by and say, yeah, don't play this. We're not playing it, and then move on to someone else.
You never know. There might be a chance that we'll visit Exhibition of Speed on the Dreamcast or something like that, or maybe even Nightmare Creatures 2, because that's a nightmare to play.
Yeah.
This game did very well, sort of its Metacritic score. It scored over 90%. Yeah, over 90%. And it's the highest scoring version of the game. The GameCube and PS2 versions didn't score as well. I would put that down to maybe the expectations of audiences by 2001 would have changed dramatically. We were already in the generation of 128-bit. People were used to more fleshed-out experiences. So, year 2000, Crazy Taxi is amazing, blowing your mind. But by 2001, you've got games like Grand Theft Auto 3 that have come out. You know, the GameCube's got its fleshed. You know, things like Reckless that have come out. So. Yeah, so expectations have shifted, so that's why those versions perhaps haven't scored as well as Dreamcast version. They're not particularly far-fetched from the Dreamcast version, it's just the DC version is the best one.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, without doubt.
Definitely.
Without doubt. I still have fun with it, just like I did when I first played it.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's absolutely fantastic. I think it's such a fun game. You can sit down, you don't really need much skill to enjoy it at all, like you did with Cannon Fodder. But that's an episode for another time.
I think Gus's car moved a lot better. You know, I think it's a lot faster than the others. I don't know. It might just be me.
I don't know because I think the female character Gina,
who
we used to think was Lita from WWF, I seem to remember. I think her car is actually the fastest on the game, and Gus's is a better handling vehicle overall.
Mm.
Yeah. But totally, I think you can get a good turn of speed from it.
Yeah, sorry, I forgot he was filming it. Sorry, we're back again. It's actually 2 hours later, because we've just been playing the game so much. We've just been on straight away.
Playing a lot of it.
Yeah.
A lot of it, but...
Yeah. Sick of it now.
Yeah, done for another 14 years. So, so that basically sums up our Crazy Taxi episode. And personally, I think it's got to the point where we give our individual ratings of the game of how the experience has played out for us.
Yeah.
Now, let's start, as we usually do, with graphics.
I'm going to give it an 8.
You're going to give it an 8?
8.
Michael's giving it an 8?
Yeah.
I'm going to give it a 9.
9?
I am. Call me some sort of rose-tinted glasses-wearing fool, but it's definitely a 9 for me.
I think 8 could be still some improvement. The Dreamcast.
What?
They could do a lot better on the Dreamcast.
Oh, okay.
Well, we've got a Disney Dreamcast on.
Good. I didn't make it, but still. Audio.
Audio, 10.
10, mate, 10. Definitely. Yeah, I'm going to give it a 10 too.
Sweet. Just purely for the music, really.
Double 10s from us. Yeah, I mean, the soundtrack is actually brilliant, isn't it?
Yeah.
Offspring, Bad Religion. I think you've got another offspring track that's actually playing in the menu as well, which is looping.
The drum beat is actually
an offspring track as well. Overall gameplay, how do we feel about that?
9?
Michael's giving it a 9. It's a smile from me, so it's definitely a 9 as well. So, going by that factor, is there anything you particularly enjoy about the gameplay?
I do like how fast-paced it is. You know, it's arcadey. You can get straight into it. You can play it straight away and have your fill. You know, if a lot of you like multiplayer games, you know, you like having a game night, you can come around. You can still do it with this. Like we said, we've just been doing it now for the last 2 hours. You know, we're taking turns, don't we?
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't always have to be split screen. Taking turns is...
Everybody gets their fill eventually.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, if you do the arcade as well, if you run out of time, boom, next person do it.
Yeah. You can really have some, like, quick-fire rounds on the game. Like you said there, the arcade mode is denoted by how good you are at the game. So you could be there for a couple of minutes, you could be there for 20 minutes.
Yeah. And if you like playing by yourself, it's perfect for you because it's a single-player game.
Yeah. And don't forget that if someone is playing for 20, 30 minutes at a time, there are many a Dreamcast out there that reset after that amount of time anyway, so it's okay.
That's
it's
right, yeah. Good.
Little folding machine.
What's the overall rating then?
My overall rating on this is, I've got a 9, a 10 and a 9, so I'm a 9.
I think I'm going with a 9.
You're a 9?
I think so, yeah. I've got 9 sounds good.
9 and 9 from both of us. Yeah. The two grumpy retro gamers, you've got a 9 across the board from us. That's pretty unanimous praise for that sort of software. Can't get angry about it. Not gonna. All right. So don't expect grumpiness from us today. It will happen one day.
Apart from the console, is the game easy to find?
Well, it sold really well, so you can find it. Not as easy as you could the PS2 version and the GameCube version. Now, PS2 version you could probably pick up for maybe £2.
Yeah, don't bother.
The GameCube version, probably a fiver.
More worth it than the PS2.
The Dreamcast version, now what sort of prices were you picking up on eBay?
On the PAL version, pretty much the only ones I could find was £10 to £15.
Okay, I still think that's actually a bargain for this sort of software.
Yeah.
You know, complete with the booklet and the original case, as long as the case isn't cracked up, then that is an absolute bargain. Now, I looked into the slightly more rigid Japanese and American versions of the game. Oh. Now, the American version I managed to pick up on eBay $20, which is pretty good, so it equates to, what, 17 odd quid.
Something like that, yeah.
The Japanese version translates to probably around about £20. Now, the Japanese version is extremely difficult to find versus the American and the PAL versions. I should think it's probably because it wasn't really catered towards the Japanese market. It was very much a Western game. So Japanese version actually wins the day here for rarity. Mm. So if you were after a rare version of the game, Japanese version would be the way to go. Can't imagine if it'd have Japanese language in it there. I imagine it would still be in English.
I can tell you.
Might not be worth wasting your time with that then. So there you have it. So you have the three regions that it came out in, and it's pretty much blanket price across the board. PS2 GameCube versions, cheap if you wanted an entry level version of the game. Alternatively, you could probably pick up Crazy Taxi Fare Wars, I think it was, for the PSP, which again is probably a handful of quid, which mixes levels from Crazy Taxi 1 and the Dreamcast exclusive Crazy Taxi 2.
Cool. But apart from eBay, where can we find this?
I'm glad you asked. Now, there are a few places. If you're local to Plymouth, which quite a lot of our viewership is, you can pick it up at the tech outlet with Aaron Johnson, Brad Parker.
Have you got a copy?
I should imagine they probably do have a Dreamcast copy.
Yeah.
I should imagine they probably do. And if not, they could probably go and grab you a copy from somewhere, I should imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Who else have we got?
We got Nerds.
We've got Nerds.
Near Market.
Yeah.
Inside and Out. Would they have a copy? I'm sure they would.
Yeah.
They've got quite a few Dreamcast
They've got quite out. A lot of Dreamcast software, yes, so I should imagine they would. And also the Wants branches in town.
Of course.
Yeah, you've got the Gold Centre, Marder Way and Market Way. I'm sure you'd be able to find plenty of Dreamcast software, Crazy Taxi amongst them, in one of the three stores.
I can't say I've seen many Dreamcast games there at your store.
There's loads.
Yeah?
There are
Maybe you should put it in the window.
Maybe.
Mm.
Definitely. So people don't have to interact with me. You just come in, look in the window. Ooh, I like that, I'll buy it.
There you go.
Don't have to deal with me.
Look through the window for it.
Don't get starstruck, okay? You have an autograph of your Dreamcast copy of Crazy Taxi if you want. It's okay. So, part of the show. Everyone waits for it. Everyone wants to be part of it. The shout-out part. What have we got? Who have you got?
Who have I got?
Who have you got today?
Who have I got? I don't think I've wrote anybody down, but
have you not?
Oh, there you go.
Okay, so we've got... glad you said it. So we've got James Chalmers, who we'd like to give a shout out to.
Of course.
We've got Christian Pease, who we'd also like to give a shout out to. Bob Phillips, John Robson, Mikey Hay, as usual. Spike as well. I'd also like to give a shout out to various different websites as well, like Retro Collect, Console Passion, etc, etc. I think these guys are great. You have people that are creating new Dreamcast software today as well. You've got Hucast Software, you have various other outlets that are creating new games as we speak for this machine, and I think it's brilliant that the games are still being created to this day. I think you've got Alice Dreams Tournament, which has just recently come out for the machine last week, so worth picking up yourself a new copy of that if you still own Dreamcast and you're still actively collecting games for it. Anybody? You've got anything?
Yeah, I've got a pal of mine that I work with, Eddie. Last Moment Victory, he just subscribed to us. He's recently started liking our show, so I'd like to give a big shout out to him. Obviously, always appreciate it, just, you know, taking interest in our shows. Last Moment Victory, that's the one. He's on YouTube as well. He brings up a lot of game stuff, so check him out. He's pretty good.
What about your hairdresser?
Oh, what, the barbers?
Yeah.
Lucas Barbers, Cornwall Street.
Didn't you give him the shout out last week?
Yeah, I might have.
Do you want a free haircut?
I kind of do.
If you're watching, Mike would like a free haircut. Okay, so basically that sums up this episode of the Two Grumpy Retro Gamers. Now, you can subscribe to us, you can watch our previous episodes. I mean, there's 13 previous episodes, people, that you can watch on various different formats. We've covered Xbox, PlayStation 2, we've covered GameCube, we've covered the Sega Dreamcast, the Sega Mega Drive, the Saturn. We have covered Nintendo 64, also PlayStation 1.
But it doesn't end there, Forbes, does it?
It doesn't end there, Michael.
No, we got Master System, we got the NES. Help me out.
We've got the Super Nintendo again. We've got the GameCube again.
Well, we do them again. Yeah, we can.
Cycling the systems. So we want to do an episode on the Master System, as Mike said. We want to do an episode on the NES. And we want to basically keep in rotation the various different systems. So we want you to stay with us. You want to stay with us.
You want to say the Game Gear. It's not happening. We're not doing the Game Gear.
Not the Game Gear. We've got no way of doing the Game Gear. And the Master System is just a Game Gear in console form. So
if anything, the Game Gear is just going to hold up this table steady. That's the only thing it's worth.
I don't like it. Steady on. Sega console. PSP, I can understand, but Game Gear, I don't even...
PSP can hold the other side.
Who even are you right about now? For God's... I'll take... See you next game.
See you next game.